Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to the PrintWeek India webinar titled Safe Packaging for Tomorrow in association with Siegwerk India. Welcome once again. Safe packaging is fast becoming the way to go. And today's webinar will see discussions on safe packaging and best practices in the packaging industry and so much more. Today, we have an interesting line of speakers who will represent supplier, manufacturer, as well as a brand's point of view on safe packaging. We have eminent speakers who will share their green checklist and highlight the details of their initiatives on the green front. The panelists of speakers today include Sukhdev Saini of General Mills, S.N. Venkataraman of ITC Paperboards and Specialty Papers Division, Jatin Tucker from Siegwerk India, and I, Priya Raju, will be your host for the webinar. At the end of the session, the floor will be open for an interactive session of question and answer round. Ensure to send in your query addressed to the specific panelist through the chat box on the right side of your screen. So let us all tune in to understand the safe packaging for tomorrow. Our first panelist is Sukhdev Saini of General Mills. Sukhdev is an alumni of Indian Institute of Packaging, Mumbai, and he has mastered the packaging supply chain by working with various brands for over 15 years. After stints with Unilever and GlaxoSmithKline, he is currently the packaging manager of for the AMEA region at General Mills. Over to you, Sukhdev.
Good afternoon, everybody. So the topic for today is the packaging for food safety. So in our day-to-day life, we all feel wherever we go, are we consuming safe food? Whatever we're eating, whatever we are consuming, is it good for ourselves, for our family? That's the question we have in our mind every time. So here is a picture wherein you have to just see and spot few hazards which can be potential risk for food safety point of view. And if you guys are just watching the picture and counting, so I can help you around. There are almost close to 20 different points which are not working in terms of good practices, or which are against the good practices of food safety. So this is not, I think, what we all aim for. This is the worst case scenario of any factory, any premise where we would like to work with. So I just wanted to highlight that food safety is one of the important parameter for all the products which we work for and which we represent. So moving on to the next slide. I am very proud that I work for a company, General Mills, which is the creator of HACCP. Now, HACCP is Hazard Analysis and Critical Control Points. And currently, it's one of the most important or widely used term. But then I would like to share that this is something which was created by General Mills, and a short history about General Mills and the HACCP association is that NASA wanted to work on this space program, and they approached the erstwhile Pillsbury company to create something which will work at zero gravity. And they wanted it to be safe and 100% sure about that this is good for their team, which is going to work in space. And the organization then came up with this tool which helped them a lot. And hence, the seven principles of HACCP, which were then coined in, later on became a target of the systems for all the other food companies to follow. Moving on. So one of the motive for us is that we serve the world by making the food which people love. And I would like to state that product safety and regulatory matters is one of the important parameters which we keep into our mind while we are designing, formulating, developing, transporting any of our ingredients, products, packaging material. So this is something which we all as employees for the organization, we all keep it in mind so that whenever we are working, we have the consumer's perspective, their lives, their safety in our mind, and then we start our work. So this is something I wanted to share with you guys, that as a person who is working in this industry, we are very much aware that food safety is prime for all the consumers. Moving on to the next slide. So what are the top food related issues which we often find in packaging? So this was a compilation of what we find usually. So in chemical issues, we find that there is off flavor, odor very often in our food. So people complain about the inks, adhesives, or in certain cases, board or film, like there is some kind of taint pickup in the food. Sometimes it is the and much, I would say, outside of Indian subcontinent, that there are undeclared, unlabeled ingredient allergens also. And I can say in India also right now, I think people are definitely getting much more aware of the allergens, and they want to ingredients, they have to declare it. All the mix-ups of packaging material, getting the wrong label on the wrong film, wrong packaging, that's again one of the concern areas. Printing errors, there is a lot of missing information sometimes on the packs, and consumers who are buying the packs, they do not get satisfied with the information sometimes. And of course, the physical foreign matter contamination. So again, this is also widely seen problem in some of our food packs. Moving on. So how do we design our pack? When we are working in terms of designing our packs, what are the areas where we look into? So we've just taken one example to showcase how do we evaluate the food safety. And this is for typically for all the primary packaging material. So one of the key steps for us to check is the residual solvent. And we check for all the chemical compounds. There's a list. It has almost more than 32 items on the list, which we check for. And if anything is beyond a certain limit, which we prescribe, we do not approve the material. Then there is a jar test, which is a physical test, a odor test, which a trained panelist, they check for the low odor threshold compounds. And the last is the sensory test. Basically, we prepare the material, or if it's ready to eat, we consume the product and we check if any package has affected the food material. So in all, we have a very strong system of checking whether our food is safe for consumption, both from a perspective of odor, flavor, fragrances, and it has led to a very good program for us in terms of food safety. Moving on. So where do we look for our concerns and problems if we find, and where are we alert? So this is a design network. So wherever the packaging material is formed, or taken care of. So right from a packaging material specifications, graphics, equipment at the factory, at our packing end, or be it at the converter end, we look at everything. Quality regulatory of all the places wherever we are working, in terms of factories, in terms of warehouses, and also the transportation systems. We have a tie-up with the logistics companies. We have an understanding that, okay, if there is any odor or any taint pickup, it will be taken care of. And of course, all our suppliers, all our raw material conversion partners, they are like treated with utmost care, that we take care of all the food safety issues at their end, and then none of them are passed on to us. And a very good robust program, which I mentioned earlier, it's in place for everybody. And the last point is the retailers, consumers also, along with our sales force, we educate them if there are any concerns. The care line numbers, the helpline numbers are always available for reporting of the issues related to food safety. Moving on. So another key step in terms of material selection. Earlier, I spoke about only the odor, the fragrance part, but then in this case, it is the overall material selection. If we are talking about plastics, paperboard, laminates, so how do we work around it? So we deploy the failure mode effects analysis, wherein we understand how can the product or packaging may fail. We try to understand the parameters which are critical for the success of that package and food product. Study the climatic zone in which the product has to be stored, transported, and also sold. So if it's a country which is in Asian subcontinent, it would be treated differently. If it's outside the Indian subcontinent, say example Europe or the North American countries, so there would be different zones which should be taken care of. Then consumption pattern. So is the consumer going to consume the product in one go, or is it going to be a multi-use pack? So that's also taken care with respect to the kitchen study, which we call as open shelf life study, which we conduct at our lab. And then checking the storage and handling conditions. So whether it's going to be a closed vehicle, or it's going to be a container load, a refrigerated container, or it's a normal container. And there is a chart which presents the different zones which I was talking about. There are altogether 5 zones which are divided. And you can know more about these different zones whenever you are preparing your product and packaging. Moving on. So would recommend whenever you are working on a material structure change, a resin change in any types of polymer based material, and even if it's a vendor location change, ink change or coating change. Very often we have found that ink change or coating change is not notified to a lot of our brand owners. In some cases, there were issues which were reported in some products. And another case where we found there was an issue was a fiber source change, where a new mill was introduced, and there were some issues which were found. So we would recommend that in all of these cases, we should definitely conduct a food safety evaluation, and we should be careful, especially in the last two cases which were neglected in the earlier cases. We should be taking care of that. Moving on. So the best quality of food and packaging is definitely possible through a good design, which is right at the inception of the concept or the idea, proper validation of that design and the concept, and then specification, writing the correct specification and working on it. Sampling, which is the testing of the product or the samples which we get from our factories, from our consumers, or from our warehouses. That has to be very robust. And last but not least is the correct reporting. So if the issues or if the complaint is reported in a timely manner or in a proper quantitative qualitative manner, I feel that we should be able to get the best quality on board. So I would like to thank you all.
Thank you, Sukhdev. It was interesting to know that General Mills was the creator of the HACCP rules. So moving on, the next presenter is Mr. S.N. Venkataraman from ITC's Paper Board and Specialty Papers Division. He is the Divisional Head Marketing for the business, and for over two decades has steadily expanded ITC's business to be a dominant player. Over to you, Venki.
Thank you, Priya. And thank you, Sukhdev, for a very crisp presentation. The number of slides I have is fairly large. So Priya, I may ask you to flip over certain slides very quickly if they're already covered by Sukhdev, okay?
Yeah.
So what I will give you over the next 20 minutes or so is a perspective on the safe food packaging from a paper and paper boards perspective. So over to the first slide. So if you look at headlines today, these are the kind of issues which are surfacing up. Okay, this is from a food safety site. And as you can see, there are recalls of waffles. Mineral oil content through packaging or in the food item as it migrates is an issue. There are issues of heavy metals or antimony in food packaging. Closer home in India, you have plastic items that are getting banned, which is more a litter pollution kind of control. And these issues are across countries. So these are all coming to the fore. And therefore, the importance of safe packaging for food, all the more now, as more and more regulations are going to come in. We know about the Food Standards Safety Association of India and the rules which have got formulated. And I'm sure there are going to be a few questions on that during the course of this event. So these are all coming to the fore. And when you come to paper and paperboard packaging, this slide is very, very instructive. So in spite of all the advances that we have made in secondary packaging and in primary packaging with our flexible packaging industry and with the secondary packaging to the paper and boards industry, a lot of old newsprint still continues to be used as a material for loose packaging. And what does it contain? It contains lead-based inks. Is not even stored properly. So you can imagine what is getting transferred to the food item as it happens. And this is something the FSSAI rules are now trying to control in India. So in India, we are starting from a very low base as far as implementation of standards are concerned. Of course, there are companies like General Mills and ITC and other companies like Nestle, which have set standards here. But then if you take the total spectrum of companies in India, I think we have a lot of catch up to kind of play on it. And if you look at our street food and other kinds of packaging, which are totally unregulated, I think they still pose a risk, and standards have to come into play and authorities have to enforce them. We'll now go to what is safe packaging as far as paper and board are concerned. I mean, what are the aspects of it? So there is something with respect to food contact. So as we know that paper and paper board is a lot secondary, except where you actually eat disposable foods. You know, when you go to a food chain like McDonald's or you buy a sweet meat or a confectionery, you pack it in a cardboard box and bring it, or you drink a beverage out of a cup. Those are all examples of direct contact in food. A bulk of the requirement, for example, of General Mills too, would be indirect contact, where it is the cereals, confectionaries, and other kind of food items which are getting packed. So with respect to food contact, therefore, there's always going to be the issue of purity of the packaging material and the components of the food packaging material, as to whether they are permitted up to a certain limit, or whether they are safe to use, and what are the migration limits and stuff like that. So how do you measure the migration limits? Depending on the food item and the way it's ingested, you would use different kinds of solvents like water, heptane, alcohol, or acetic acid. And then you go to the production process of the packaging material in case of paper and boards. So during the production process, however modern it may be, there could always be certain elements which come in, which your packaging regulations or food regulations do not allow. So in the paperboard making or paper making process, for example, if you use chlorine bleaching, you could have unacceptable level of dioxins, and dioxins are carcinogenic in a kind of way. If you used in your coating of binders, or if you use plastic packaging, for example, you could have phthalates in the mix. And of course, your material should be handled very carefully. There's a lot of water during paper making and many other manufacturing process. So if it's contaminated or otherwise comes from a material which is not stored properly, your microbial activity or level could also be very high. And what that causes is some unacceptable level of odor. Wherever there's microbial activity, you could have the odor which was talked about. And so they also did touch upon it as one of the key requirements, you know, in evaluating food packaging. So you have to look at all the inputs of the paper or paperboard and what they conform to. So there are standards, as you'll see later on, like FDA and BGVV, to which they have to conform. You'll also have to know how the material is going to interact with other elements. So I think Jatin is coming after me, and he's going to talk a lot about inks and coatings and solvents. So interaction with inks, adhesives, and solvents in the pack formation process are also important. And it then goes through processing and filling lines, which may impose their own requirements, and to distribution and final consumption. So that again depends like a bit on the geography, as how it is getting consumed and what other effect it may have on either the food item or in relation to the packaging material. So conditions of final use, you know, temperature, humidity, are you going to reheat and use it? And the overall public health regulations covering safe packaging and safe food in general. I will flip the next slide. I mean, these are the normal requirements in terms of evaluating appropriate packaging. So I'll not dwell on that. And we'll go to the paperboard's evolution. So broadly, there is recycled paperboards, and then there is virgin fiber-based paperboards. And while recycled fiberboards continue to be used a little bit for indirect food packaging, even in case cereals and economy kind of products, which have a mass market, more and more are shifting to virgin fiber-based packaging, especially where you have newer regulations covering, say, mineral oils or odor and stuff like that. I think people move to virgin fiber-based packaging. The difference between the two is one of strength. It's also one of purity. And it's therefore one of final performance that you get. So with recycled packaging, you're likely to have more issues with respect to odor, with respect to its performance and running filling lines. And maybe some of the constituents aren't entirely acceptable for, you know, high quality food products and what they might transfer to the food products. Paper and paperboard, next slide, please. So it's normally used for indirect food contact. So where it comes into direct food contact, you have to impart a barrier between the paper and the food product. So how do you do that? So through polyolefin coatings, a PE coating is one such route to get it. But you have a new regulation coming up in terms of plastic waste, and therefore people are looking at alternatives. So people are now experimenting at the higher end with biodegradable coating, which can biodegrade and be composted if picked, and if you are industrial composting facilities. You're also looking at some kind of functional coatings, which are imported through, let me say, dissolved polymers. So polymers which are dissolved in water or in some other kind of solvent can also work and impart some barrier properties. These never equal the films that they're replacing, but to some extent, they do provide some extra amount of barrier, and they're all recyclable. So that's a big advantage of grease-resistant coatings, for example, which are there. But they come with their own hazards, if I might say so. So if you have fluorochemical-based coating, for example, it's unacceptable in most countries, except probably in the US to some degree. So you have to find an alternative to such barriers. So just to give a big overview of all the packaging regulations, the next two slides actually cover that. So you see a timeline from 1958 to, say, 2011, when you look at both the slides together. And where did it all start? It probably started in the USA in terms of regulations with what's called the Food and Drugs Administration, you know, enunciating certain rules. And I think they still form the basis of most of the packaging compliance for food packaging. So the Food and Drugs Administration has made rules, and they're all codified in a particular code, which is called CFR 176, 170, and 171, as far as paper boards are concerned. And these cover direct and indirect food packaging, which can be for different kinds of food products and different conditions. And they cover inputs which are permitted to some degree, and a process for declaring newer inputs in order to get conformance. So the FDA is probably the most important regulation in order to comply. And most national legislations, including the ones that we have in India, be it a BIS standard for food packaging or be it anything else, will refer back to the original FDA. In fact, for operational purposes, I think FDA is the regulation which is actually followed in India with respect for compliance to food packaging. So the approach of the FDA is to list permitted inputs and have controls through migration limits. I mean, I'm putting it in a very simplistic manner, but this is the approach of the FDA. So it looks at different kinds of packaging, from paper, plastics, to all the materials and coatings. And it looks at the ingredients which are permitted in this packaging. It allows certain exemptions. And then it looks at the various kind of products which are kind of packed, and has some recommendations in terms of annexures with respect to the kind of inputs which are permitted for different kind of foodstuff based on its particular use by people at large. And you have to comply to that. And essentially, the migration limit is one of the things. And there are other regulations which get added. The second most important legislation covering this would be legislation originating from the European Union. So the European Union has an overall framework regulation, which is called 1935/2004 on materials and articles which come into food contact. And arising out of that, there are various legislations. And out of this, the Germans codified a certain standard, which we follow as BGBB 36, which is the German standard. It's more or less similar to the FDA and prescribes migration limits for approval of material. Of course, the Chinese have their own standard. And while we don't have an HACCP like in the manufacture of a food product, you have what is called a BRC global standard, which is the British Retail Consortium standard for the food packaging materials. So you should ask your supplier, who is a printer converter, or you could ask even somebody like us, who is a paperboard packaging supplier, or a film supplier, for example, as to whether they conform to this BRC global standards, which is the packaging version of HACCP in a short form. So there are labeling regulations, of course, and of course you end with what is most recent in India, which is the Food Safety and Standards Authority of India, the new rules that they have prescribed. They in fact have, in the last edition, recommended certain types of packaging for food products, as saying that these are prescribed and preferred. So you're now getting into a rule where it's getting slightly directed as to these are the preferred methods of packaging. And you know, any company in the line would want to follow this in total. Now, as a next slide, I just touched on one aspect because we get a lot of questions on whether you can use recycled fiber boards, recycled fiber-based boards in food packaging. And if so, under what conditions? So as I did mention, you could use it a little bit for indirect food packaging. And it has its limitations because recycled fiber means you're collecting secondary material from a lot of places and countries and then mixing it to form a board. So there is no way of sterilizing all these fibers totally before they bond. And if you did treat them too heavily, then you know they would not form a fiber matrix in a paper board. They, of course, contain, since they are secondary waste, which is collected from post-consumer and a little bit pre-consumer, they would be contaminated with ink, solvents, other adhesives, and the like. How much of it gets removed during the paper or paperboard making process is always open to a bit of a question. So if you used what is called pre-consumer waste, and if you knew the origin of your rest of the material, the recovered or recycled fiber, from where it came, you could ideally make some recycled board which conform to, say, FDA standards for indirect contact. I don't think under any condition it would be recommended for direct contact because it's not a manufactured material and there's no way of controlling its quality in toto. But if you had very strict control on the batches of the raw material that you got in terms of recycled fiber, maybe you could make a board which would meet with the indirect contact, and that's the only way. But it means extra controls, and you know, you have to be very sure that the sources don't contaminate and are maintained very properly. So that's about recycled fiber boards. So virgin fiber boards, as I told you, virgin fiber paper or boards that are used in packaging. So you make it mainly out of virgin pulp, and therefore there are no contaminants. the technology there has been changing so that the chlorine bleaching has gone out and you use what is called oxygen and light ECF bleaching today. So these are all very friendly processes as far as the environment is concerned. When you do make something out of virgin fibers, you can have a very high bulk and stiffness. So as many people who are users would know. You could add selective additives and barrier layers, which will be covered a bit later in the presentation. And of course, they all, you know, conform to a good manufacturing practice like BRC. And virgin fibers, which, you know, are grown from sustainable plantations, would mean that you are ultimately doing a closed loop kind of cycling. And as long as it comes back and you plant more, for example, for the virgin packaging that you do, you're also doing the environment a good turn by fixing carbon dioxide and increasing the green cover. So typical paper and paperboard packaging in direct contact, as you can see, secondary packaging, you know, for some cereals, for a confectionery, a bag-in-box format, as a liquor carton, as a biscuit secondary carton. So these are all examples of paperboard in indirect contact. And the next slide is about paper and paperboard in direct contact. So here you can see from paper cups to wrappers and liners, for example, for fast foods, or for your cakes, cupcakes, ice cream cartons, for example, the Tetra Pak, the aseptic liquid packaging carton, the trays which you see, and other takeaway boxes. So more and more, as you go into organized retail, you are getting to see a lot of this packaging coming into the direct contact packaging coming into play. I think many of us who are in this packaging line of business also know that with effect from March or April, you know, the government is going to notify rules on waste regulation, plastic waste regulation, and recycling. So we really expect to see a lot more activity on the paperboard side with respect to the direct contact packaging, which is there. We talk a lot about paperboard, so I also have a little bit on some of the lightweight papers which have always been used into packaging. So all of us know about butter paper. So how is it made, which is a parchment kind of paper, which was the original barrier paper, so to say. Then you have glassine, for example, which has been used in grease and oil resistant applications. All that gave way to plastics as time went on in terms of both barrier performance as well as runnability on the lines. At one time, if you all remember, your chocolates used to be in a kind of twist wrap paper because paper had good dead fold properties, as they say, which film still doesn't have or is trying to match. But film has, of course, much better barrier properties. So there is always this yin and yang or the give and go of what happened between various packaging materials. But today you are going to see something like this wrapper product which we show here, because you are taking ordinary grades of paper, lightweight paper, treating them with maybe a polymer and imparting certain special properties, functional properties. So it can be moisture resistance, it can be oil and fat resistance, it can be liquid or water resistance, for example. So these kind of functional properties can be imparted. And for example, for cupcakes, it is also a bit of barrier to the fat which is there, as well as the release property which is required, you know, to release the cake from the mold. So how does one do all this? I mean, this must be the question agitating the minds of many of the listeners today. So what do we do in order to make sure that the paper or paperboard is very safe? So we look at all our inputs and we only do approved chemicals. So approved chemicals are to FDA and BFR standards. And we follow up a system of supply compliance as well as, you know, annually get into testing some of these samples and getting your declarations updated. The OBAs, which are in paper, very often they are the cause for not meeting the migrating limits. So you use OBAs, for example, which are a bit more food safe of the latest generation and help you to meet the migration requirements. And microbial activity, which I did mention to you. So you need to have a process where, you know, there is no tanks or other items in the process which contain water from where this microbial activity can increase. And that always causes odor, apart from impacting maybe the color of the paperboard or staining the paper or the board, for example. And as you go more and more, there are regulations which are coming in, that paper machine, the big machine, and, you know, even the lubricants which are used on the machine for the various rolling parts, for the bearings and for the shafts and all that, should actually have a lubricant which is compatible with food packaging standards. So there are many items like that to take care when you actually want to deliver product day in, day out through the year in order to meet the requirement of a particular brand of food or beverage. So magnetic separators at the wood chipping process so that you remove metallic contaminants. This particular bleach process which we follow, where you can see that there is no elemental chlorine at all which is used. And we use a lot of peroxide and what's called chlorine dioxide, which is momentarily created and then does the bleaching and then disappears. So it's much lighter on the environment, and it also produces less dioxins and furans, so that you can meet that target of one part per trillion. Some of the fibers can be treated through what we call a hot dispersion process, which separates the plastic contamination and stickies, makes the fibers purer to use. There are sentry cleaners in the process to remove the sand and dirt particles. You remove the ammonia from the coating colors. It also removes some of the odor which can be present, and some amine formation, which may always again be detrimental to the product meeting a food standard requirement. And you of course have GMP at your factories. So we are probably the only paper company in South Asia, maybe even in Asia for that matter, to have some of our main production lines conforming to the BRC standard. So that's a big achievement. Apart from a barrier plant at Polaram, our main paper machine which makes virgin boards itself conforms to the BRC standard. And you should have full product traceability in case anything goes wrong. You're able to retrieve and, you know, actually limit the damage or share the information with your customer as to what details have been provided so that further analysis and evaluation can be done. What are the kind of testing that you do? So along with microbial activity, bacterial count in paperboard, GC headspace analysis for measuring chemical presence of any newer elements that you use or anything that may cause some off order. Priya, I think you have to go one more slide. Then migration tests, as I told you, which are done for every product as well as renewed on an annual basis with an external party, dioxins and furans, and then electronic nose test, for example, for determining others. We also have a panel-based Robinson test for order, and that's done for in batches across our mills on a separate basis. So all this is to deliver a paper and paper board, which is absolutely safe for use day in and day out. And if there are any further questions at the end, I'd be glad to take them. Thank you.
Thank you, Venki sir, for the in-depth presentation. So moving on, the next speaker is Jatin Takkar from Siegwerk India. Jatin is a qualified food technologist with over 8 years of experience in various verticals across the food industry. After stints in companies like Nestle and Kraft Heinz, he currently heads the product safety and regulatory division at Siegwerk India and is responsible for formulation of compliant products. Over to you, Jatin.
Thank you, Priya. Thank you, Sukhdev and Venki, for sharing your deep insights on packaging safety. And good afternoon to all the attendees. And I appreciate you all for taking time out for your busy schedule for this webinar on safe packaging for tomorrow. So in my part, I would be highlighting the need for deploying an integrated approach across the packaging supply chain to ensure safe packaging for tomorrow. Yeah. So let me share a brief on the agenda I have for you on today's webinar. I will be sharing Siegwerk perspective on packaging safety as to why it is so important to discuss packaging safety. I will also emphasize why ensuring compliance is a complex process and cannot be achieved without the integration of stakeholders in the supply chain. I will also discuss with you on how Siegwerk supports its customer to achieve compliance for the final intended article, that is the packaging material, which may serve as an example for the industry. And last but not the least, for all those who stick till the end, will also receive a short success mantra to safe packaging. Next, please. Priya, next. Yeah. So Siegwerk strongly believes that packaging safety needs to be critically monitored, and producing compliant products is a must in today's scenario. Now, we attribute three major reasons to it. The very first thing is regulation following scandals. So what I mean by this is, now it is a vicious circle imbibing consumer awareness, scandals, and strong regulations. So every time consumers are getting more and more aware, scandals will follow up, and finally, it will all lead to evolution of a stronger regulation. And this is what Venki showed in his presentation, the evolution of regulations. And I think this is what exactly is happening in India post the emergence of FSSAI, that is Food Safety and Standard Authority of India, where strong regulations are being continuously evolving from the FSSAI inception across the food packaging chain. The second reason is migration risk. So whether we talk about packaging material or more specifically, we talk about the packaging inks, these are primarily the mixture of several chemicals. And some of these chemical contaminants have this potential that they can reach out to the foodstuff, thereby impacting the consumer safety and what we can also precisely call the food safety. So I must let you know that packaging inks are really one of the most nasty elements of every packaging structure you come across, and hence needs due attention when it comes to assuring risk on account of migration. The third reason why we need to take packaging safety as a must is that issues in this world are going public quickly. So in this world of digitalization, any bad incidents report concerning food safety spreads across the nation as well as across the continents very quickly. And hence, being a responsible partner in the supply chain, it becomes our responsibility to not only preserve our brand image, but also the brand image of our partners in the supply chain, especially the brand owners which are most impacted in case of any food safety issue or scandal. Next, please. Yeah. So now we need to analyze that why we are talking about integration of stakeholders, or why the integration of stakeholders is crucial to develop a responsible packaging supply chain. Now, if you could recall the Nestle scandal 2015, although it had as such nothing to do with the packaging, but it sent out a clear message that if a food scandal happens, it will not only impact the brand owner, but the entire supply chain will suffer. Let me rephrase it for you. Being the responsible partners as an ink manufacturer, converter, or the substrate manufacturer, all the stakeholders in the packaging supply chain needs to be compliant and then integrate to deliver the compliant final intended article. Else, entire supply chain is bound to suffer the consequences, which could be your brand reputation could be at stake, your market segment will deplete, there will be some direct, indirect costs which will be shared across the supply chain, your operations and volumes will get impacted. So if Maggi is not produced for 7 months, then the entire supply chain is suffering for 7 months. And also in some cases, if you are at fault, legal actions may be taken against the specific stakeholders. Hence, everyone in the packaging chain needs to integrate. Stakeholders often talk about cost of compliance being quite a bit. But my friends, please believe me, cost of compliance will always be less than disaster of non-compliance. Now, let us understand why ensuring compliance is a complex process and why it needs integration of stakeholders in packaging supply chain. So the very first reason is migration. Migration of chemical contaminants. Now, in the said context, migration basically refers to the process of transfer of chemical contaminants from the packaging material to the product or the food itself. However, this process of migration is quite complex and is dependent upon several factors. Now, for your understanding purpose, let's take the example of packaging inks. Now, for packaging inks, migration will be dependent upon the application weight of the ink, will also be depend upon what migrant we are talking about, what is the size of that migrant substance. It will also depend upon the storage time and temperature of the product. It will also depend upon packaging application details, which include what is the substrate, what's its barrier efficiency, what is the packaging structure as such, by which process we are printing this. Either our packaging is for food or non-food. And if it's for a food, is it a dry food, liquid, or it's an oily food? So all these parameters makes the difference in terms of migration. And it makes clear that unless and until this information is shared between the stakeholders, no one can assess the risk on account of migration, and hence can never actually ensure packaging safety in real sense. Next, please. Another challenge for ensuring compliance is the three pillars all upstream stakeholders needs to accommodate to ensure packaging safety. And it it again needs an integrated approach to address this issue. The three pillars are regional regulations, the individual brand owner requirements, and complex packaging value chain. Next, please. Next. Yeah. So let's take each pillar separately and understand how an integrated approach supports in delivering the compliant packaging material. Now, the very first, regional regulations. So different countries' packaging materials are regulated by different regulations, and very often the structural approach as well as the regulation itself are quite different from one another. Now, some countries may lay down regulation on the food contact materials, while other may lay down regulations on packaging materials, while other countries may even lay out very specific regulatory requirements on substrates or packaging inks. Now, if you are catering to a domestic market, each stakeholder, whether it's a substrate supplier or an ink supplier or an adhesive supplier, they need to know about the regulatory requirement applicable to their product and adhere to that specified guidelines. Now, for obvious reason, each stakeholder may take responsibility of its own product. However, when we talk about the final intended particle, the packaging material itself, it is a diverse combination of substrate, inks, adhesives, etc., which are normally sourced from different suppliers and hence needs integration amongst stakeholders for assurance of compliant final intended article. Just to give you a brief example for your understanding, a migrant concentration in different components of final article, such as substrate or inks, may be within the specified safe limits. However, the cumulative effect of the migrant concentration in the final article, that is the packaging material, may make the entire article non-compliant. Moreover, if you are into exports, then adhering to local regulation as well as the regulation of importing country becomes extremely important. And here, the role of integrated approach as well as selection of a reliable partner becomes extremely, extremely crucial. Next, please. Next. Yep. So the next one is individual brand owner requirements. So there are certain brands which, due to their stringent approach to food safety, have created specifications beyond the legal requirements of the countries to safeguard their products across the globe. Now, in such cases, it becomes extremely important for the brand owner to proactively communicate such specific requirements to the printers and ensure that the same requirements are catered to the stakeholders across the supply chain, so that everyone takes care of the requirements as per their individual responsibilities are concerned. Next, please. Yep. Now, the third one is complex packaging value chain. Now, for understanding, let's go through the depicted photograph, which shows how the supplier, converter, and the ink manufacturer, or it could be a substrate manufacturer or an adhesive manufacturer, are knowingly or unknowingly integrated already. So as you can see, normally the food industry prepares the specification, which is then conceptualized by the converter, and then the very specific requirements are catered to the concerned stakeholders, such as ink manufacturers for preparing the ink, substrate supplier, or for an adhesive provider, who then probably develops the product as per the application details, and then ensure the supply of this product with the advice on the application of this right product. However, in the Indian context, the system of process validation done by converter and final validation executed by the brand owner, specifically in terms of compliances, still needs to be strengthened a lot. In such scenario, no one will debar the converter or brand owner from their responsibility to validate, but careful selection of the upstream stakeholders, such as an ink manufacturer, can definitely reduce their risk. Having said that, would again like to emphasize that the print buyer and printer should always validate the final article to ensure food safety. Next, please. Yeah. So also, just to give you an idea on how Siegwerk supports its customer, we would go through the three pillar of compliances we follow. The very first one is systematic processes. So Siegwerk basically rely upon systematic processes, which forms the backbone of ensuring compliances. And it includes your raw material introduction process, formulation guideline, and good manufacturing practices. Siegwerk also believes in the product safety guidance, and hence we proactively and transparently communicate with all the stakeholders of the packaging chain in terms of not only the technical information, but also with respect to the compliance and the regulatory requirements. Third, proactive work for product safety. So Siegwerk, being a leader in packaging safety, has been always on the forefront of integrating the packaging supply chain, sharing the knowledge and generating awareness through its workshops, seminars, and other initiatives. So this is how Siegwerk makes the initiative of bringing the supply chain together. Next, please. Now, if you need to know more about compliances, Siegwerk has put forward a yet another knowledge sharing platform to which everyone can have an access to, and it is called as Ink Safety Portal. To get the access to the wide variety of information and compliances, you can just simply log on to www.siegwerk.com. Next, please. Yeah, so as committed in the beginning of the presentation, please find the success mantra for safe packaging. So number one, select a knowledgeable and a reliable partner in the packaging supply chain, which are experts on compliances, which know how to ensure the compliances for the products. Select your supply chain partners, which have a systematic approach of delivering you safe and consistent products. So always look out for the systems in your supply chain partners. If they do not have systems, then it's bound to fail. So if you need safe and consistent product, you need to deploy a systematic approach. Third, ensure that your entire supply chain is integrated with an open and transparent flow of information across all these stakeholders, which will finally equip the assessor to ensure compliance for the final intended article. So if whatever I have covered in the presentation makes sense, then probably we need to understand that we need to communicate the brand owner, the converter, the upstream stakeholders. We need to openly communicate about the applications, about the requirements, if we really want to ensure packaging safety. So finally, a bonus tip to express my gratitude for staying till the end of this presentation. So if you are looking for a one-stop solution for complying systems, your search will always end with Siegwerk. Next, please. So thank you, friends, for your patient hearing and interest in attending this webinar. If you need any further details, you can always reach out to me on the details presented on the screen. Thank you, and over to Priya.
Thank you, Jatin, for such insightful presentation. Hope you all enjoyed the session, and I'm sure each one of you will have a number of questions to address the panelists. So we already have a few questions that we have got. So we will now march on to the question and answer round. So the first question is for Venki. So it says, a lot of multinationals and food and pharma brands require regulatory compliances. Since ITC is at the forefront, does ITC have a guidance and advisory cell where it can brief customers and other stakeholders about what to do and what not to do?
Okay. So it depends on what kind of advisory services are required. So if it is to do with overall compliance of food contact materials and something to do with good manufacturing practices, for example, in a converting line, I think our technical services team would be able to handle it. So we do it for many converters as a part of our normal service, and there's no extra fee for that. So this is something we would be able to assist customers in India with. We have an audit which we do. It's like a self audit on how well we comply with the various packaging regulations annually. Many of our customers, the more global type of customers, also update themselves on the various packaging regulations and seek conformance from us. So I think we have a very good database as far as most food products and applications are concerned. And by and large, our technical services team would be able to advise customers on this aspect.
Okay, thank you. So the next question we have is for Sukhdev. So it reads, due to adverse impact of toluene, global brand owners like Nestle, Ferrero, have restricted or completed or have completely banned the usage of toluene and ink formulations. So your company is supposed to be one of the companies to have done so in India. So what were the challenges that you saw when you shifted from toluene to toluene free inks?
So I would share there were like three major things. One, yep, being able to map the supplier readiness, their capabilities. Second was the testing of the inks and the final packaging material. And third was the cost component, which was going to be impacted. So okay, these three things were key, I would say, the key challenges which we faced, and mm-hmm, we were able to work on them.
Okay. So there's one more question for Venki. So it says the use of paper cups are seeing a boost in the past 2 to 3 years. Some state governments have strict rulings about use of 40 micron plastic cups. Does there have been some talk about PU coatings for the 25 billion paper cup that are manufactured and used in India? Can you please throw some light on the topic, which is deemed hazardous and what is not?
Okay, so let me try that. So I think, number one, I think paper cups have been growing not just for 3 years, it's been growing for the last 15 years. Having been in this industry for quite some time, I should say that ever since the liberalization happened, 2003-04, and consumption started increasing, travel became more, that's when paper cup usage kind of started going up. And it was, of course, aided by low-cost missionary coming in from Korea first and later on China. So that's what led to the growth of the industry here. So that's number one. Now, as far as 40 micron plastic cups is concerned, that is more an issue of littering and collection. Okay, so most plastic cups, as you know, are made out of polystyrene. And it's becoming very difficult to collect thin gauge plastics in general. So these are regulations at a municipal level or at a panchayat level. That, you know, that when you go around our cities and towns and even our villages, there's a lot of plastic which is strewn around. And if you take last year, 2017, for example, or the year before, 2016, even in Bangalore, Bangalore Municipal Corporation actually enunciated several rules where they banned plastic cups below a certain micron. It has been there in Hyderabad here and other cities too. So that has more to do with littering. Okay, that's not so much an issue of beverage or food safety or migration from the cup material, if I might say so, in terms of contact. But it's more to do with the littering aspect. Of course, there are other aspects about plastic cups in terms of whether any recycled content is going in and is it safe for use. But I think the ban or the limitations in usage arise more from control on littering and waste. Now, right, if you take a paper cup, especially a paper cup which is dispensing a beverage content of somewhere between 65 to 100 ml, you know, that's the smallest size of cups that you get in India, like in Bombay for the cutting chai and stuff like that. So the smaller the paper cup has become, it become more closer to plastic in terms of cost per cup. Let me put it that way. It won't be the same cost, but come more closer to the plastic cups in terms of cost. So smaller the paper cup has become. So if you take the smaller paper cups, which is where the main consumption is there in India, it is 92-93% paper or cellulose fiber by weight, and only about 6-7% by weight is plastic. Okay, so to that extent, it is definitely more recyclable. And there are our Coimbatore unit where we make recycled board, we like to collect the cups back if they are not stained or otherwise treated better. Okay, and then we try to use them as virgin fiber again in one of our products. In fact, that's a recycling success story for us. Now, a paper cup is a bit more easily maybe collectible than a plastic cup. I can only say a bit more. So there are challenges with respect to collection too here. But especially when you supply to institutions or otherwise, compared to the overall retail market, paper cups are generally recyclable and they're still 92-93% by fiber and only 6-7% by weight of polyolefin. And therefore, from that extent, they are more recyclable and probably safer to use. I don't know whether there's any hazard in using it. There have been a lot of messaging in social media and WhatsApp about wax cups being used. But I don't know where they originated. Wax cups were all used in 50s, 60s. Okay, they are not used now except in laboratories, for example, or in hospitals, for example, where some amount of wax cups are still used for collecting some fluid or blood or something like that. So in general, the usage of wax cup has gone. Once polyolefins came into the stream and you could extrusion coat paper with PE cups. They are safe to use. They meet migration limits. That's all I would be able to say. The rest depends on the good manufacturing practices done by each manufacturer. So that's where it that's probably the picture I'd like to share.
Right. Okay, super. So the next question is about the role of FSSAI in India. How do you view it? More importantly, how do small and mid-sized company keep tabs on the rules and regulations and compliances that are issued by FSSAI? So I think this question is more for Jatin and Sukhdev. So anyone who wants to take it?
So I can I can say that definitely the role of FSSAI is very critical in terms of food safety and the overall environment which we are living in currently. And if I have to point out two, three things, they provide a very good regulatory framework to work with. And along with that, protect the consumers, their interests, and also in certain cases, they are aware of the industry concerns also. So it is a forum where people can go and then talk about the concerns, and they frame the regulatory rules or laws accordingly. And on your point of how do small companies work around it, I would like to say that I think the best way would be like companies have to get a regulatory person on board, either an employee, or they can appoint a consultant who is an expert. And if they cannot afford a consultant or they cannot have a full-time person, I would definitely say that then they can connect to some of the groups which are working on this particular platform. Example, I think CII, FICCI, ILSI, and there are many other groups which are actively working on the regulatory framework, and they can update them on the latest thing. And the last could be like, yeah, there could be people who can be self-aware and they can read literature on these things. And there are certainly publications wherein the latest notifications, rules, laws, they get published. So people can be aware of those things.
Yep. So Priya, for me, I think FSSAI post-emergence is definitely upgrading the standards across the supply chain, not only to packaging, but across the supply chain. They're definitely raising the bar, and it is obviously a positive change if you think about consumer safety, if you think about the day-to-day life of a consumer. And in terms of how do small and mid-sized companies tab on this rules and regulations, so probably these notifications do reach out to these small and mid-sized companies, either directly if they have a regulatory guy, as Sukhdev has mentioned, or they are a part of some association. So those are two means how these guys are getting this information. But I think what is more important is that these regulations in some ways need to be given to other stakeholders. Like if a regulation is changing in terms of packaging, it needs to cater down. So for this, they are obviously uploading this on notification, uploading it as a notification on the website, which everyone can have an access to. So that's how I see that small and mid-sized companies are looking out on these rules and regulations. Yep.
Okay. So the next question is again for Jatin. It's from BK Swine. He asks whether solvent-based blister coating is safe for food packaging.
Come again, Priya.
So he is asking whether solvent-based blister coating is safe for food packaging.
Okay. So with this question, I think I would like to make a point. It all depends how you formulate those formulations. So to say that every solvent-based blister coating is safe, it won't be correct. So it all depends on the formulation. So as I told that inks is basically a mixture of several chemicals. So in case if you're putting in any one non-compliant material, the entire formulation will be non-compliant. So in generic, to say whether a solvent blister coating is safe, I don't think that's an appropriate answer would be. So it all depends upon the how you are formulating it. And this is the reason why I'm specifically telling about integration of the stakeholders. So if a brand owner does not inform the converter that this is going for a food or pharma segment, and if the converter is unaware of this application, they do not tell the ink manufacturer, then ink manufacturer will obviously choose the low cost thing to get the business. So this is the reason why I stressed about the integration. So if the flow of information is correct and an ink manufacturer knows the end application of this, so he can give you a solvent-based blister coating, which is compliant and which will be safe to use.
Okay. Great. So the next question is on... The next question is says that National Green Tribunal deadline is approaching. Are Indian converters and film suppliers ready to be compliant if NGT bans this multi-family plastic laminates? So what's the update on that front? Sukhdev, can you elaborate?
Yes. So right now, I think everybody is getting ready for that. And there are various points to that notification, which came out in March 2016. I think one of them is the multi-layer plastics, the ban on them. Or rather, I would say that it is saying that don't use multi-layer plastics or make it recyclable, actually. So there are different, understanding. There's a difference of understanding amongst the professionals or the companies which we are discussing this concern with. So I would say one of them is the multi-layer plastics. People are either changing their substrates, they are looking at the recyclable substrates, or else they are also looking at how can we recycle the multi-layer plastic. So there are various ways and means with which those plastics can be recycled. And then there is an entire game of handling the waste. So basically the extended producer responsibility, which is EPR, which might get affected, enacted from March or April 2018. And that's basically all the brand owners and manufacturers will be responsible and will have to pay for the plastic waste which we are generating. So again, that's a different stream of work altogether. And certainly everybody is doing the R&D work and planning to have a solution in hand for this deadline.
Okay. I would like
to add just a couple of points to what Sukhdev mentioned. So, yes. You know, this plastic waste management handling and regulation rules have been there for now last 4 or 5 years. It has gone through many consultations.
Right.
I think Sukhdev gave a very good brief on it. But like you said, as far as multi-layer plastic are concerned, there is no absolute ban. Okay, there is going to be something which is going to incentivize or lead towards recycling. And this extended producer regulation where everybody in the chain starts contributing to the recycling of the same. So end of life use of the packaging material is really the issue. And mixing of different origin plastic materials could also be one. So, you know, if you use a multi-layer packaging, which had both polyester and say a polyolefin, then you might like, it doesn't become recyclable in the classic sense for either polyester or a polyolefin. Okay, so if you reduced one element in that packaging structure, okay, which made it suitable just for say, polyolefin recycling by eliminating one other plastic which was there in the layer structure, then that gets incentivized to that degree. I think that's the R&D work which is now going on with a lot of flexible packaging companies and maybe with multinationals and the bigger Indian companies too. The other aspect is plastic can be collected, and I think in our highways now, the government has authorized usage of up to 5% or 10% by plastics in terms of road filling, which is also a way of recycling plastic, but not for the same use. Okay, it's kind of downcycling, not upcycling. So it's not in terms of the recycling aspect. And the final aspect would be, can they burn? So we have done some experiments, for example, in the larger ITC context, where we use a lot of films for our food packaging. And you can actually take some of this plastic material and incinerate them at very high temperatures in industries like cement kilns, for example, where they need energy. So there is calorific value in plastic, which is derived from, finally, anyway, from a crude oil. And there may be a cost associated with collecting and burning it, but there are therefore ways and means by which they can be recycled or burnt in order to produce energy. I just wanted to give that view.
Okay, great. So Venki, the next two questions are also addressed to you. It's from Karthik Bansal. He's asking whether parchment papers are recyclable. And whether they can be used for the same packaging purpose as that of the original use.
I don't think so. So what happens from my knowledge of chemistry would be that in case of parchment paper, you're actually, see, paper also is made of polymers, but it's not made out of long chain polymers like your polyolefins, nylon, or your polyesters and all. It is made of cellulose. Cellulose is a polymer. But you have to see it as a short molecular weight or low molecular weight kind of polymer. Second, in paper, the polymerization is within the cellulose molecule, and the paper gets formed, it's individual fibers which get aggregated to form the paper. Okay, the polymers don't have chemical reaction among themselves. The fibers have the bonding between themselves. So coming back to parchment paper, which originally is from cellulose, it gets treated in an acid bath. And when it gets treated in an acid bath, the degree of polymerization increases. So you know what is the first plastic or the first polymer? It was cellulose acetate film. So from the 1900s, somebody in the USA, I think, which company was it, DuPont or not DuPont, it antedates DuPont, I think, invented the first cellulose acetate film. So what we know as cellophane or celluloid, which is used for our film making earlier, all came from the cellulose acetate. And that was actually, therefore, paper or some kind of paper, parchment paper, which was totally polymerized by treating it in an acid bath. Okay, so once you polymerize something to that degree, it doesn't get regenerated in the same form as a fiber. The recyclability of the paper comes from the fact that you can ultimately convert it into individual fiber fragments and therefore recombine it in the form of a new paper. At least if you recycle it 3-4 times, after that, you know, the fibers start losing strength. I mean, that's the conventional view and theory which supports it. The moment you polymerize the paper by treating it in a sulfuric acid bath or something like that, which is what happens when you make parchment paper, butter paper, you are actually creating a new material from the original material. So if you kind of repulp it, you are not going to get back paper fiber. You're going to get back only polymer fragments. And you cannot make paper, therefore, again out of polymer fragments.
Okay, so we have a number of questions that is being poured in, but we'll take up this one last question. It is from Varsha Amte, and she's asking, any eco-friendly alternative to impart barrier properties in the direct food packaging other than biodegradable polymer? So any one of you can take this.
I will add a bit and maybe Sukhdev can follow. So we are working on options today, what is called dispersion polymers, or polymers which are dispersed emulsions in water. Okay, these are aqueous emulsions. Okay. Now, they may not have the same barrier property as a film or a multi-layer film, but they will have some amount of METR or WVTR, moisture water vapor resistance rates, and they lower it to some degree, and to a lesser degree on OTR, which is the oxygen transmission rate. So in food packaging, fast food packaging on the go, for example, or if I stretch it a bit, even if we develop a coating through the emulsion that is heat sealable for a paper cup, it may just be possible that you can work on some of these functional coatings and they can substitute to some degree polyolefin usage. All this would mean replacement mostly of polyolefins which are used in barrier. But where you require higher barrier requirements, okay, METR lower than one or oxygen transmission rate lower than one or something like that, paper, even with the aqueous polymers, probably may not meet. But people are working on options, but we are some way away from at a retail level, developing a flexible paper packaging, which is treated and which can match the current flexible pouches.
Okay. Thank you, Venki. The one last final question would be for Jatin. Your CEO Ashish Pradhan had announced that the Siegwerk Bhiwadi site is now toluene free. So how do you spread this message to the brand managers and buyers and as well as the consumers?
Yeah, Priya, so that's absolutely true that Siegwerk India is now completely toluene free. And this change was definitely not an easy one because there were challenges pertaining to adaptability of this in the market. Then there were some issues pertaining to the performance and obviously the cost, because when you go for something which is compliant, you need to pay a bit higher price. But I think over the years, ink manufacturers have evolved in terms of technical performance and have also narrowed down this gap of toluene-based and toluene-free ink systems in terms of cost. And I really see that now the awareness in the brand owners and converters have evolved. And even in the absence of regulations, brands and converters are getting more and more responsible. And this drift to toluene-free inks is getting more stronger with every passing day. And this was the reason why we decided to get completely toluene-free. Now, in terms of how do we spread this message? So for previous quite a good amount of years, we have been conducting workshops for the workshops in terms of awareness sessions for the brand owners and converters. Then we have also been conducting seminars for the general market, where not only the brand owners and converters, but also the institutes, your third party institutes, are also invited. And then we are also utilizing different social platforms such as LinkedIn, and without doubt we are utilizing media channels such as magazines to generate awareness on compliances and specifically the toluene free inks. So this is how we are spreading this message to brand owners, buyers, consumers. Yeah.
Right. Since there is a limited amount of time available, we will ensure that all the remaining questions from the attendees are answered via email. So thank you everyone for attending this webinar. Hope this webinar was insightful and a good learning process for you all. Thank you all. Thank you, panelists.
Thank you, Priya, Sukdev, and Jatin. Thanks a lot.